Okay, when we teach a new area or new subject where the students or the learners don't have any knowledge, in that case, this method is the best way, right? Teacher control teaching. Because they don't know A to Z, they don't know anything about a new subject. In that case, we can't take a other approach. We have to take the class in our own way, right? As a teacher's way, we have to continue the class. So in that case, these methods are useful. Or you can think, we are going to teach a child a new thing, or how to read it, or how to write properly. Then what's the best way? We have to show them, right? We have to show them, let them watch, let them see, and then after some time only, we will allow them to do it, right? So in that case, teacher control teaching is useful. Now come to this interactive procedure of learning. Especially among teams, adult learners, or matured learners, when we teach grown people or adult people, then this will be the ideal way. Question answer method. So interaction is there, right? Both parties, the teacher and the learner, are interacting. That's what the purpose of this, right? This type of teaching, normally if you take school like environment, normally this is the most common way, right? Lecture method. But here in adult learning, university, higher education institutes and so on, this will be the best way, right? So question and answer method. Sorry. So question and answer method, likewise, interactive procedure, group discussion. So we divide the group and we can let them. In Zoom also, there's option, breakout groups. Right? If we give it, will automatically divide. And tutorial methods. Tutorials. Likewise, seminar, panel method, symposium, like that. So here, in all these, panel method, you know, right? There's maybe this kind of table. So panel discussion. We can have panel discussion. So everyone's idea is shared together. So there is interaction. Like seminar or tutorials, a group discussion like that. So here, this is part of interactive procedure of teaching. So here, learning control teaching. Learning control teaching means, so for example, now let's say I want to teach you classroom management. Then I give 5 questions, like we show in the exam paper define classroom management for disruptive behaviors and so on. Then if I ask you to write the answer or to find out the answer, what you will do? Because my purpose is to teach you classroom management. So in order to make you learn, I am giving these questions. So if you find answers to these questions, then I can make sure, okay, you understood this classroom management. So for that, so based on the question, I am letting you on your own, right? You can do in any way. You can use your own way and you can find the answer. So one way is programmed instruction. Programmed instruction. Even this we can use for programming, teaching programming also. We can tell input two numbers and step by step we will get the output, right? So programmed instruction. So with the instruction manual, we provide the learner, then the learner will learn. So programmed instruction. Likewise, self-directed learning. So these are somewhat similar, right? Self-directed learning. Then library method. So for example, we give some question. So we take this example again. Then I tell them, okay, you all go to library and take this book, for example, teaching methodology. In this book, answers are there for this question. You go to library and read it. That way also it's possible, right? In universities or in higher education institutes, this is also possible. Learning control, our control is based on the learning, right? So the learner has to go to library and he has to learn it to find the answer to this question. And also computer assisted instruction, laboratory methods. So we may have some manuals. So based on the manual, those who use laboratory, they can do that. Or likewise, another way is assignment, right? Another common way we use under learning control teaching is assignment. So for example, if I want to make sure when we learn this subject, right? When we learn this subject, assume yourself as the teacher, right? Not as a student. So I am a teacher, so I want to apply these methods when I teach to my student. You have to have that kind of thinking, right? When you learn this subject, you assume yourself as a teacher, right? Not as a student, right? So now let's say I want to make my students learn Photoshop. I want to make my student learn Photoshop. So what I can do, I can simply give it as assignment. I can give it as assignment, or otherwise, I want you all to learn Photoshop. Sorry, not Photoshop, PowerPoint, right? PowerPoint. Then what I can tell, I can give a title. I can give a title. Under this title, you prepare a PowerPoint presentation as part of your assignment. Then you will learn, because it's assignment. So learner will, without failing, they will try to do this assignment, right? So these are some of the ways. So in this subject also there are assignments, right? So we will discuss later about that after a few classes. Then group control teaching. Group control teaching. So okay. Okay, sorry for the inconvenience. Let's continue now. So now the as part of continuation, there's another way of teaching is there, that is group control teaching, right? So action oriented or democratic teaching. So like the interactive one, here also we give some tasks based on group. So project, we can give a group project. Right, sorry, now I hope you can see the slide, right? You can see the slide now. So project method, simulation instruction. So simulation, what is mean by simulation? Simulation means, for example, when we teach about facing interview, how to face an interview, we can set up a mock interview, a sample interview, right? We can ask all of you to attend the interview, like you actually attend the interview with your certificates and all, with the way how you will dress for the interview. So in that way, we can ask you to come for the interview, and we can give the feedback based on how you attended the interview. It's a simulation method. So we simulate the actual environment, and we teach them. We give that kind of exposure to the learners. Likewise, field trip. Right, field trip. If it is applicable, we can take the learners to the field trip and let them learn. Field works, survey, workshop, problem solving method, or problem based learning, case studies, right? Like that. And role play. Role play means we pick the learners and assign the learners to different roles. So let's say we take four people, we assign one learner or one student as a manager, another one as a project manager, then software engineer and network engineer and so on. Then we can ask them to perform their role. So role play. Narrative means we narrate the situation and they act. Narrative and conducting experience, storytelling, field observation, model building and bus session. These are different methods we can used under group control teaching, right? So there are too many, so I'm just skipping some of them, right? So now come to the important part, lecture method. This is one of the traditional way of teaching, right? Lecture method. So lecture method. So the lecture is a teaching procedure consisting of the clarification or the explanation of facts, principles or relations. So it's the lecture method. The lecture is a teaching procedure consisting of the clarification or the explanation of facts. We explain for the purpose of explanation of facts, principles or relationships, this we can use lecture method, right? So a lecture, meaning reading, is an oral presentation intended to present information or teach people about a particular subject, right? So it's a lecture, right? So if you want to explain about the facts, principles, or the relationships, you can use this kind of lecture method, right? So usually now the one that I am doing is also, you can take it as a lecture method, right? And also I am trying to use some other method. I am using a tablet just to make the tablet device. So that's using that only I am writing on the slides, right? So to make it little bit interactive, right? So it's a form of lecturing. So this is some of the interesting part of lecture, right? So if a lecture must have this kind of characteristics, right? It's not a standard one, but anyway, out of experience, people have created this one, right? Lecture should be lively. Lively means active one. So it should be lively, so there should be an interaction, and also educative, right? Educative. There should be something to learn to the audience. There should be something to learn to the audience, and it should be creative, right? It should be creative. And thought provoking, right? Thought provoking means we should stimulate the thinking of the learner, right? We should stimulate the thinking of the learner. Thought provoking. So they should feel better and make the students understand. It should be relevant, and also it is enjoyable. It is enjoyable, right? Lively, educative, creative, thought-provoking, understanding, relevant and enjoyable. Then it will be very effective lecturing, right? So unfortunately, since we are continuing, we are online for this teaching methodology module. If it is a live lecture, we can do a lot of practical things inside the classroom, right? But anyway, now we will try to learn what is possible within the possibilities, right? Right. Right. Now, when you do the lecture, or when you are planning to teach something, you have to ask these questions and you have to have some answers to your mind, right? Before starting to prepare a lecture, the teacher must be able to answer 4 basic questions. If you are a teacher or if you are someone who is going to teach something, you should have answers to these basic questions, right? You should have answers to these basic questions, right? You should know who is your audience. you should know who to whom you are going to teach. What is their level of knowledge? What is their level of knowledge? Sometime maybe, for example, I don't know whether in this class everyone can understand Tamil, right? Isn't it? Is there anyone who can't understand Tamil in your class? Is there anyone who can't understand Tamil in this class? Can anyone tell if any of your friends here in this class cannot understand Tamil? Ah, okay, there is one student, right? There is one student who cannot understand Tamil. Okay, fine. So this kind of things is what you should understand, right? So now I need to speak in English. I need to speak in English. So you should know your audience. You should know your audience, right? Then who are they? What are their characteristics? So now you are, all of you are IT people. Then whenever I take an example, I can take IT related example. Now if I teach the same subject, if I teach the same subject, teaching methodology for English language students, I can't take IT example. Sometimes they may not understand, or for the other people. So you should know who is your audience. Sometime maybe you should know the genders, whether it's a, what kind of genders are going to attend the class. It's a mixed class or the boys only or girls only, those kind of class. Because sometime in the class, sometime when we use examples, it should be very suitable to all the audience attending the lecture. So that's why at the beginning, it is very important for us to understand about our audience. We should know who is our audience, who are going to attend the lecture. And then what is the purpose of your lecture? So why you are lecturing? What's the purpose? Or what are the objectives? And then how much time is available? How much time is available? And what is the subject matter? What you are going to teach? These four are obviously very important questions, right? You should have answers to this. When you are going to teach something, you should have answers to this. You should know who, to whom you are going to teach, why you are going to teach, what's the purpose, and how long you are going to teach, and then what you are going to teach. Then you have a very clear idea about what you are going to teach, right? So this is useful when you, if you want to deliver effective lecturing, right? Lecture delivery. Lecture delivery. When you make a lecture delivery, there are different things you have to consider, right? First one, speaker audience distance. So here, lecture delivery, we are talking about physical lectures, right? We are talking about physical lectures, right? Let's see here, you are standing here, right? So the distance, how long is the, or how much is the distance between the speaker and the audience, right? Lecture speaker audience distance. body movement and stand. So if you are in a classroom, you should not stay here for like a fixed one, or you shouldn't be seated in the chair with the table, right? You can move. You can move here, you can interact with the students, right? So on. That's a body movement and stand. And your facial expression. Your facial expression is also important. And also gesture. Gesture, right? Any idea about gesture? Gesture means you are maybe sometimes we show hand signals, right? This is like gesture, right? If you want to show the victory using our hand, we show like this, right? These are gestures. Our hand gestures, right? For example, if you tell there are three tips, for example, there are three tips, using your hand you can show three fingers, right? So that's what the gesture. So your body language, along with your body language, you can use the gesture, and also the tone of your voice. Tone of your voice, right? So based on what you are speaking, you can control your voice. Whether sometime you can use a loud voice, sometime you can use a soft voice, and so on, right? And the strength means how active you are in the classroom. So you have to make a movement and so on like that, right? If you are rigid in one class, then it will not be interactive. So were you able to listen and understand? So the interaction between the students and how the learners are interacting with the teacher, right? Right. So you can see most of the things mentioned here in that particular video, right? So enunciation, pronunciation, rate of speech, the variety, the differences, right? And pauses. Pauses is also important, right? So you shouldn't at a stretch, you shouldn't continue the lecture and finish it, right? Where necessary, you make some pauses. You have to take 1 or 2 minutes break in the throughout the lecture, then it will be easy for the audience to digest, right? So these are some of the key elements we can focus when we deliver lecture. And then advantage of lecture methods, right? Advantage of lecture method. So what are the advantages of lecture method? So factual information, right? Sometimes we assume that teacher is more knowledgeable, or he's the authority in the subject, he has the correct knowledge about the subject. So if we use lecture method, we can give the correct information, factual information to the students, right? We can give the accurate information to the student. Right? Otherwise, if we ask the students to learn themselves, sometimes they can learn the correct things, or sometimes they may incorrectly understand something. So lecture is useful if you want to give the factual, actual information. Lecture is one of the good way, right? That's one of the advantage of lecture method. So, and also it is useful for large gathering. If you want to teach something to the large audience, you can take the lecture method. Let's say there are 200 students. You want to teach the same thing to 200 students. Lecturing is the best way. If you divide them into groups and each group have 5 members, what will happen? We'll have 200 students or we'll have 40 groups, managing them again becomes a very tough task, right? So it's useful for large gathering. If we are dealing with large number of students, so the best way is to go for the lecturing method. And also it is very cost effective. It is very cost effective compared to other options. Lecturing is very cost effective. We need very limited facilities and we can educate large number of learners, right? And also it is very quick and straightforward. It is quick and straightforward. It's a straightforward method. And also it's a most common way, right? Around the world, lecturing is the most common way. You take any university or any higher education institution in the world, lecturing is the most common way, right? And also it is useful method for auditory listeners, auditory learner. Auditory means someone who learns by hearing, someone who learns by hearing. So it is one of the useful methods, lecturing, for the auditory learner, right? And also it is easier to create. So you can easily prepare and you can easily do it. If you want to arrange a workshop or something, there are so many efforts you have to take. You have to make the arrangement and so on, right? But lecturing is very easy to create and deliver. The same way, familiar methods. It's very familiar to everyone. So the teacher is also familiar and also the learner is also familiar to lecturing method. So it is easy. And also it will save a lot of time. It will save a lot of time. So like this, in this example, we want to teach the same thing for 200 students in a large hall, in a large hall with a projector and a mic, with a speaker, we can convey the message to all the people. The same thing, if we divide into groups and if you want to take a different methodology, like group discussion or workshop or presentation like that, then it will take a lot of time and lot of resources, right? Lot of time and lot of resources. So these are some of the advantages of lecture method. So we can share the factual information, useful for large gathering, cost effective, it's a very straightforward way, and it is useful for auditory. Auditory means people who are through your learning by listening, right? And it is easier to create. It's one of the familiar methods also, and also it will save a lot of time. Right, okay. So with this slide, we will wind up today's session, right? Like there are advantages of lecturing method, there are also disadvantages, right? There are also disadvantages. So here, lecturing is always content centered. It means based on the content of the lecture. Based on the content of the lecture, it is moving, right? So here, what it means is, through the lecturing method, let's say now I have some slides. So based on the slide only, I'm continuing the lecture. So it is, we are totally dependent on the content for the lecture. So that is content centered. So it's one-sided, meaning more into monology. It means most of the times the lecturer or the teacher is interacting, not the students. They are just listening, right? It's a kind of a one-way communication. And also not everyone can do lectures. Not everyone can do lectures, right? It needs proficient oral skills. So teacher need special oral skill in delivering the lecture. If they don't have this skill, then lecture become boring and uninteresting. It means the lecture should be in very good in language and also some other oral skills. Otherwise, it becomes very boring and uninteresting, right? And also finally, passive audience as against active audience. Because as it is content-centric, most of the times lecturers is delivering the lecture, so the participants are very passive. They are just listening, or sometimes they won't be listening, right? So very passive audience. And also, lecturing minimizes feedback from students. So most of the times, we are unable to get real-time feedback. We are unable to get real-time feedback. So we don't know whether students actually understood or not. We don't know students actually understood or not, right? So that's one of the, these are some of the disadvantages of lecturing method, right? So these are some of the disadvantages of lecturing method, right? So then, as a continuation, so no place for any practical activity. Usually, there is no place for practical activity, observation or experimentation or demonstration, right? Right, no place for any practical activity, observation, experiment, and demonstration. And also, lecture method is not suitable for students with lower class. It means students who are in lower classes, grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, like that. Or students or children with below grade 4, grade 4, this is not suitable. One-way communication, right? So that's why in primary classes, they have activities, right? Outdoor games and so on, right? Because lecturing is not suitable for those age group students, right? Because they won't learn. They need practical things to learn. So based on their age and their behavior, lecturing method is not suitable for them. Right, so these are the disadvantages of lecture method. So that's all for today, right? That's all for today. From here, we can continue how to improve lecture methods. So from next class, right? So I will share the notes, right? I will share the notes. In addition to that, before concluding, let me summarize what we studied today, right? So we had introduction, subject introduction, then brainstorming. I requested you to answer some questions. Then we discussed past paper 2016. Do you have a batch WhatsApp group? Then I can share it to one of your batch rep, then he will share it to your WhatsApp group. So that way you can easily get the slides, right? And the same way I will make some edits and upload the lecture to the YouTube. So if you have time, you can refer it. And under the past paper, we discussed there are 6 key areas were there, right? Classroom management, teacher, who is a good teacher, teaching aid, right, and teaching methods, and also questioning, and then finally we had lesson planning. Right, these are some of the key areas that were covered in based on past paper 2016. So based on this and other past papers, we can develop our syllabus and we will continue, right? So thank you very much for your participation. Hopefully in next class also we will continue this. Until that, thank you very much and have a good day, right? So there is a request to give my YouTube channel. Wait a minute, I will share it. If you want, you can subscribe that too, right? So not only this lecture, all the lectures and IT tutorials I'm sharing in my site. If you want, you can join and subscribe it, right? So like this, I will create a playlist under this subject and I will publish my lectures. So whenever you need it as a reference, you can refer it, right?